Hey, good morning, everybody. So thanks for coming to this talk. I know it's early on a Saturday morning, so thank you. And I want to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present this talk. So let's start. Little bit about me. My name is Monika Puhazhendhi. You don't need to try and pronounce my last name. I'm a software developer at Quantum Inventions. So what we do in our company is we do mobility services like navigation, routing optimization, fleet management, dispatch management, and so on. And for the last 1 year, I've been working on a new product of ours, which is called Slick. It is a keyless car sharing platform, which means that you can share your car with another person without having to transfer a physical key to them. You just download the key on your phone and you can share the car. So we started on this about a year ago, and we have been using serverless computing for this. So about 11 to 12 months in serverless. So this talk is basically whatever I've learned through my journey in the last 1 year. And what I'm trying to do here is give you an overview of what serverless is and address some of the things that I wish I knew when I had started on this journey. Okay, so let's start. So let's see a show of hands. How many of you know what serverless is? Okay, how many of you have worked with serverless? Okay, so for the rest of you who have not worked with serverless, this is probably where you are on the graph. You think serverless is cool, which it is. Like, everybody's talking about it, it seems easy to use, and there's a lot of hype around it. Then you go through the process, then you find out you have too many expectations, and at one point you feel like, why did we even start this? Just go back to server-based architecture. Then you start asking the right questions, and you reach some kind of balanced view. So I think our team is right now at the beginning of the slope. We have just started asking the right questions, so we don't yet have all the answers, but it's an ongoing journey. So first, let's get one misconception out of the way. Let's define what serverless is not. It's not this. Serverless doesn't mean that there are no servers. There are servers. It's just that you don't manage them. You don't run them. You outsource it to third-party providers like Google, AWS, Microsoft, and so on, who manage the servers for you. So you just worry about your application's concerns, and that's all. Before we break down what serverless is, let's take a look at how we got to this point. So we first started with bare metal, which is you buy your own physical servers, and then you set up your OS, security patches, web server, applications, and all that, and you manage and maintain them on your own, end to end. Then you got virtual machines where you can, it's a simulation of another system, it's almost like another computer system, and you can run multiple virtual machines on a single physical computer, so you got more flexibility. Then, and I'm making a leap here, we got containers. These are basically lightweight, standalone, executable packages of code. So this means that you get all that you need to run your application packaged in your container. You have your code, you have your libraries, runtime, tools, whatever that you need. Now we are at functions as a service. What this is you have small components of functions that you've basically done, it's your business logic, and you deploy them and they scale independently and granularly. So we will see what this means. Another way to see this is that traditionally you had to manage this entire stack from top to bottom, from network storage and servers until applications and data. Then when infrastructure as a service came, which is things like EC2 instances, you could offset half of these things with storage and servers and network taken care of by the cloud providers, and you only worry about the rest. Then you got platform as a service, which is you get your own runtimes. This is things like Heroku. So they set up the runtimes for you, and all you need to worry about is how do I manage my applications and how do I worry about my data, and that's all. So in this picture, where does functions as a service fit in? So let's first define what functions as a service is. So FAS is, very simply put, stateless functions run in ephemeral containers. So let's break this down. Stateless functions means that you don't, when the function is run, it has a state, but before and after that, you don't, there is no state outside it. There's no global state. And this is by nature of it being run in containers. And it's called an ephemeral container because the container is spun up when you need the function to be executed, like when you need an image to be processed, the function is, the container is run up, is spun up, the function is run. And once its job is over, the container is brought down again. So it is transient. It doesn't stay alive forever. And because of this, and with each request, you get another function that's invoked. So there is no state maintained between one invocation to another invocation. These are the most well-known functions as a service providers, AWS Lambda, Azure Functions, and Google Cloud Functions. These are the major cloud providers, AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud Platform. One thing you need to consider when you go down your serverless journey is, before you even start, look at what the Google Cloud provider, not the Google Cloud, look at what the cloud provider is offering, their entire ecosystem. Because you might start with just serverless, like just Lambdas or just Azure Functions, but you will quickly realize that you will need other things like DynamoDB, API Gateway, and so on. And when that happens, you will start realizing that you become dependent on these things, and some of those consequences start hitting you later on. These providers have very different billing, and they have very different, not very different, but quite different ecosystems, like how API Gateway is in, how API Gateway is built in AWS versus how it's built in Azure is very different. So take a look at the whole ecosystem before you decide to go down with just one provider. So some of the characteristics, the main ones of function as a service is, first, that the servers are fully abstracted. This means that when you want a function, when you want to specify a function, you just tell how much memory you want to allocate to it, like 128 MB, 256, and so on. And that's all you need to do, like literally. You don't need to say what EC2 instance, what type, micro, mini, nothing you need to say. And the cloud provider itself will do this for you. They will figure out what infrastructure you need, and they will set it up for you, all out of the box. The second thing is that the scaling part, which is what is its most differentiating factor. So the scaling is event-driven and not resource-driven. What this means is that you have more granularity. If you have one function which does image processing and another function which does something else, and both of these come within one particular web application, you can just this, the image processing function alone can be scaled up because there are a lot of images coming in, and the other functions don't need to be touched at all. This means you don't have to spin up an entire server just because one function is being called too much. So this gives you more granularity, and it's more economical and more efficient. And you only pay for what you use. This means that we said that they are ephemeral. That means you only pay for the duration when the function is being executed. So the moment the function finishes execution, then the container is brought down. Actually, even before the container is brought down, once the function finishes execution, the container is kept alive for like some time in case you get more requests to make it more efficient. But you don't pay for any of this time. You only pay for the duration when it's being executed, which is very useful. Like if you have burst traffic patterns and why should a server be sitting around consuming so much money when you don't need it, right? This picture is basically just to show you what the landscape is like. There are so many things around here, and I don't know even like 25% of this. Some of the most well-known things are the ones that are highlighted here. You can take a look at these. These are all like topics of their own. So I will be concentrating, like all my examples and information is informed by serverless framework. It's kind of weird, like serverless doesn't mean serverless framework. They just decided to rename it from something else to serverless. So be careful when you're Googling for serverless. The concept and the framework are two different things. So serverless framework claims that it's cloud provider agnostic, which is why you see that there is AWS, Azure, and so on. So they say that you can use any of these cloud providers. You can spin up Lambdas or Google Cloud Functions or Azure Functions as you wish. But I will be focusing on AWS, the most prominent cloud provider. And I want to reiterate why choosing your cloud is important, cloud provider is important, because when we started down this path, we chose serverless framework because it's agnostic, right? So we can switch if we want. But it's not that simple. Once you decide to use Lambdas, and then we started using API gateways, then DynamoDB, and then suddenly it's hard to switch to Azure, even though there some of the things are cheaper there. So really take a look at the ecosystem before you start down this path. A quick overview of how Lambdas, AWS Lambdas are triggered. Some of the events that can trigger it is an API gateway request, which is a HTTP request to the gateway, a new file being uploaded to S3, a storage service, a new record being inserted into DynamoDB, and a new message coming into the queue, SQS, or the Kinesis stream. So let's look at a very fairly simple example from this picture, at least. So this is an weather application, which is it's a web app with a front end, and the customer is trying to get some weather details, like the temperature. So the front end itself is hosted on S3. This is like you have a single page app, and the front end code is hosted on S3. And when you want to, when the request comes from the browser, the information is the page is directly served by S3 itself, from S3 itself. And now the user clicks on a link to get the weather information, and then now you need to get the information from the backend, from some database. So you make an API call to a say API gateway. Now this is an event trigger for Lambda, and this calls a Lambda function, which basically goes to DynamoDB, makes a query, gets back the information, and returns it back through API gateway. So fairly simple. Now, given this example, let's just understand how the function lifecycle works. You would have heard of the term cold start when it comes to serverless. So what that means is, so the functions, since the functions don't exist until you actually invoke them, there is a startup time to it. So this first part, which is called the full cold start, this is the unavoidable part. This is the time that it takes to download your code and start a new container. So every time a new Lambda function is invoked, this first part cannot, you can't touch it. This is dependent on how the cloud provider has done it, and you have to rely on them to make this really fast. Now the second portion, where the runtime is bootstrapped and then your code is started, that is a part that you can try to optimize. So this is where choosing your runtime becomes important. Like if you choose Java, the delay is quite a bit, but if you choose something like .NET, the delay is significantly reduced. So this is something you should look at. And once you start your code, if there is more requests coming in and the container has not been brought back down, then the first three paths, the first three steps don't have to be executed anymore. So you just have to, you just have the warm start part alone. So this is what you should aim at. This is the best use case of function as a service. So when you are looking at how to architect your serverless architecture, you need to look at traffic patterns. These are some traffic patterns that are possible. Any high spikes that you see implies that new Lambdas are going to be invoked. And this means that there is, if new Lambdas getting invoked, that cold start portion is something that you can't avoid at all. So this implies that there is going to be some latency. This is something you need to take a look at. When you have low traffic with periodic activity, this means that for a long time, there is no functions being invoked. And then when you have some activity, functions are being invoked. Again, this implies that you're going to have cold start delays. So there is one option that some plugins provide where you can warm up your functions by just invoking invoking them like dummy functions time to time to keep them alive, so that if there is a request that comes in, there is no cold start attached to it. Now the middle traffic pattern, whether it's an active and predictable traffic, this is something where you need to consider, you could consider a hybrid pattern. Because if you know that the traffic is predictable, then maybe it doesn't make sense to have your Lambda functions. Because if they're going to be running all the time, then what is there's not much use to it, right? So you can have a server that serves your requests, like a server-based architecture that serves your requests all the time, and probably have some Lambda functions just in case when there are high traffic loads, like just before a Black Friday sale or something. So you can consider a hybrid pattern in this case. So I'm going to go down some of the other key things that you need to consider and some of the things that they're both pros and cons to these things. You will begin to learn a lot more once you start doing this on your own. Most of this is just based on hands-on experience, and mine is pretty informed by what I have done. So I suggest don't trust anyone, do it yourself to find out. When it comes to scalability, the main advantage that function as a service provides is that your functions can be scaled granularly. That means that each function itself can be scaled. You don't need to provide compute power for all your functions. And that gives you a lot of granular control, which is really good. And when you have burst traffic patterns, this kind of setup helps a lot. Because you don't want a server to just sit around for no reason until there is high traffic. Some things you need to consider here is that don't assume statefulness, that like I said before, and this also implies that don't you have to design for horizontally scaled parallelism. Like there are going to be multiple instances that are going to be running the same code. So if you have database requests and eventual consistency and problems like that, then you need to think about all of this before you design how your function implementation itself is done. Logging, so this is an example from CloudWatch logs. So the logging is there, but you have some issues with parsing these logs. Like, they're hard to parse. Right now, there's not enough, there are not many mature tools which do this well for you. And at the very least, you need some structured kind of logging. Then you can set up some CloudWatch metrics which triggers some alarms or events if there is an issue that's faced, like some error messages that are coming in. There are some third-party services like Dashbird, IOPipe, Epsagon, which do these things for you, but they are still not mature enough. But this is rapidly evolving, so keep an eye out for that. Monitoring is one of the biggest pain points when it comes to serverless right now. The tools are not yet mature. You do have a few options, like I said, Dashbird and Epsagon, but they are not yet mature. Like, how they do monitoring right now is they take a Lambda role, which you assign, and this Lambda will now process all the logs, put it into their system, and then it will try to do some processing of the logs to give you some meaningful data out of it. But this is still not as good as you want it to be. So debugging becomes hard. But this, again, is progressing pretty rapidly. So things can change a lot in 1 year. This is an example of Sentry, which is an error alerting system. So serverless framework has integration with Sentry. So as a basic example, it shows failures, like when a Kinesis event triggers a Lambda and then it fails, it understands that there's a failure and then it throws you a Sentry warning. Again, this is not foolproof, but it is getting there. And one of the things you can that's useful to know is that there's this thing called dead letter queue. So when you have Kinesis messages that are coming in, and then it goes through a Lambda and it's not getting processed. Now you're just stuck with this message. What do you do with it, right? So you can push it to this thing called dead letter queue, which is a target for messages that were not processed. Then later on, you can take a look at these messages, see what went wrong, and act upon them. This is traceability. Again, this is a problem if you have a microservice architecture. So if you have several microservices, if you want to find out why this particular user experience failed, you don't want to test just one API. You want to test like a bunch of things that happened, right? Like multiple APIs that probably span across multiple microservices. Traceability right now, with the help of things like X-ray, you can do tracing within a microservice from one function to another, from one Lambda function to another, but they don't yet have support for microservice to microservice. So this makes debugging hard, and debugging is pretty time consuming also here. Again, this is a pretty big pain point. You have this thing called vendor lock. So like I said, choose your cloud provider carefully. You can easily get vendor locked. You have to see what runtimes they provide, what versions of runtime they're providing. Like for example, AWS only supports Node.js 8 until now. They have not yet upgraded to 10. The kind of billing they do, the billing pattern for AWS versus Azure is very different. What kind of security is put in place, you need to consider that. And basically, when you're using all these cloud providers, you're giving up your control. You need to think about that. How much control are you willing to give? So let's come to development. If you're a developer in serverless, what are the things that you need to know? First thing is local development and testing is hard because you're using services that are hosted on the cloud, which means that some of those things either need to be simulated on your local system, or you can only test it when it's deployed. So you need to have staging environment where you're deploying it. You can't test it on your own machine. There are some options here, like for example, there's a serverless offline plugin. There's a DynamoDB local plugin. These are all things that you can use to simulate things on your system itself, but they're not matured enough yet, and they don't cover all the third-party services you will need. There is a limit on the function duration. Like Lambda, how long a Lambda function can run. You need to think about this. Like if your function is time consuming, it's going to take a lot of time, you need to think about how to split it across multiple functions, because it'll just exit if it hits this time limit. One more thing is, because of the nature of functions, that they are stateless, if you're trying to access an relational database, right, you don't have the concept of a connection pool, because each function makes a connection separately. So you don't have a connection pool which is being kept warm for you. So this actually increases latency. There are some approaches given where you throttle the connection, but this just means that you don't cause a denial of service problem, but it doesn't actually solve your problem. You still have the connection pool issue. So be careful that you do close your connection before your function exits. Okay, so based on whatever I said, right, this is the example we saw. In reality, it looks something like this. It will look something like this. And it's actually, this is pretty simple. Like, the architecture that we have is even more complicated than this. So I'm just saying that this can grow into a monster very quickly. So be conscious of that. There are a lot of design decisions that we had to take. These are just some of them. I'm not going down this path because each of them is a topic of its own. But if any of you want to discuss this, and do catch me after this talk, I would love to hear what you think and if you have other approaches to these problems. Some of the recent updates from the last reInvent 2018, they have open sourced runtimes. They have this thing called Firecracker now, which launches lightweight micro VMs for you in a non-virtualized environment in a fraction of a second. It sounds a very cool thing. I've not taken a look at it much. They have introduced new runtimes like support for Ruby. They have support for custom runtimes. This means that you can use any programming language and just compile it so that it can be run on Lambdas. They have this thing introduced called Lambda layers, which is pretty useful because if you have several functions and they all use, use the same dependency libraries because you have this across your system, then you don't want, right now your functions are, each function deploys, packages this dependency as part of its deployment package, and you're deploying it for each function, which takes up space. So with Lambda layers, you can now push these libraries themselves into a package of their own, and then all the other functions can access them from this Lambda layers thing. So this is pretty useful. They've also started supporting integration, more integration with other AWS services. Like, for example, they have load balancer support for Lambda functions. This means instead of using API Gateway, you can directly use a load balancer to target your Lambda function. This can be useful if you want to migrate from a non-serverless architecture to a serverless architecture. You can do it one service at a time. They have this service called Aurora Serverless. Aurora is a RDBMS provided by AWS, and Aurora Serverless is optimized to be used with serverless computing itself. So this could potentially have a solution for the connection pool issue. They have DynamoDB on demand. This is useful because DynamoDB, you have to provision the capacity at the beginning itself. So if your users scale from 1,000 to 10,000, then you're going to have a problem. So DynamoDB on demand helps you to address this issue where if it exceeds what you have provisioned for, then you can start using this. Conclusion, the tip on the top is what you see, serverless, but there's a huge set of things that you need to care about that are lying below the surface. So start looking at the whole architecture, look at the big picture when you're going down this path. But serverless is here to stay. It is evolving, and based on all the reinvent updates and things like that, you can see that it's being actively supported. So this is the time to get into it. Like, this is the time when you can go through the journey. You can be part of the maturing process. So you will learn why things are changing the way they are. Like, why are they introducing new services? Why are they cutting down something? So it can be a very insightful and informed journey. So do get into serverless. It is easy to start off, at least. Then maintaining is a different question. These are some of the references I've used, so if these slides are going to be public, you'll be able to see them. And that's all. Thank you. Any questions?
All right. Thank you, Monika. I believe many of us have learned a bit about serverless from this talk, right? So any questions just before Monika wraps up?
Can you flash the resources slide again?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Any questions, any takers?
Okay, I think this is an interesting one. I was taking pictures on the slide.
Okay. If there are no questions, once again, thank you very much for the session on serverless.